Check them out.
Artificial intelligence is the area of computer science that deals with designing and implementing programs that are able to mimic human cognitive abilities, thus displaying characteristics normally attributed to human behavior, such as problem solving, perception through vision, learning, drawing conclusions, understanding natural language. Some applications of artificial intelligence are understanding a natural language, computer vision, heuristic classification, speech recognition, and game playing. We are going to talk to you about the game chess and how artificial intelligence has an impact on it. The history of chess goes back centuries ago. Games related to chess were played already from the remote antiquity. The history of chess spans some 1,500 years. The earliest predecessors of the game originated in India before the 6th century. From India, the game spread to Persia. When the Arabs conquered Persia, chess was taken up by the Muslim world and subsequently spread to the southern Europe. In Europe, chess evolved into roughly its current form in the 15th century. In the second half of the 19th century, modern chess tournament play began, and the first World Chess Championship was held in 1886. The precursors of chess originated in India during the Gupta Empire, where its early form in the 6th century was known as Chaturanga, which translates as four divisions of the military: infantry, cavalry, elephantry, and chariotry, represented by the pieces that would evolve into the modern pawn, knight, bishop, and rook, respectively. Now we are going to talk about the connection between artificial intelligence and chess. The computer must consider all possible moves generated by an initial state and has the ability to predict the outcome of the game after a large number of moves. The people choose with a heuristic way the alternative moves without being easily encoded in a function. Also, they have some intuition about the outcome of the game, and with their experience, they can think completely mechanical, especially in the early and late stages of the game. Now, let's see about the chess machines that have been created through the years. The first who gave the idea for a chess machine was Baron Wolfgang von Kempelen in 1760, who created a fake machine. This machine was nothing more than a good chess player who was crammed into the machine. It is an amazing fact that the first chess program was written before computers were actually invented. It was written by a visionary man, Alan Turing, who knew the programmable computers were coming and that once they were invented, they would be able to play chess. Alan Turing was very interested in chess and he wrote the instructions that would enable a machine to play chess. Since there was as yet no machine that could execute the instructions, he did so himself, acting as a human CPU and requiring more than a half an hour per move. Another important mathematician is Shannon, who was the first who was actually founded the algorithm of Minimax, the most important algorithm in a chess program mode. In 1958, the first chess program wins a human. But should be noted that the opponent was the secretary of the company that developed the program, and her knowledge of the chess lesson was limited to 30 minutes before the race. In 1966, MacHack is the first computer that participates in human tournaments. It took part in the tournament scoring novice in Massachusetts, one draw and four defeats. Deep Thought was a computer designed to play chess. Deep Thought was initially developed at Carnegie Mellon University and later at IBM. Kasparov defeated the chess computer Deep Thought in both games of a two-game match in 1989. Now you can see a game that Kasparov played versus Deep Thought. Garry Kasparov is a Russian chess grandmaster, a former world chess champion, and he is widely regarded as the greatest chess player of all time. Deep Blue was a chess-playing computer developed by IBM. It is consisted by 256 processors in parallel connection, and it can calculate up to 200 million moves per second. These are the creators of Deep Blue chess machine. On your left, you can see Feng Xiong, and on your right, Murray Campbell. In 1996, despite Kasparov defeated Deep Blue with 4-2, Deep Blue is the first computer that manages to win a chess game against the world champion under regular time controls. In 1997, in a rematch game, comes the big surprise. Deep Blue won the deciding game 6 after Kasparov made a mistake in the opening, becoming the first computer system to defeat a world champion in a match under standard chess tournament time controls.
This was suspense beyond anything the world of chess had ever known. Garry Kasparov, 34 years old, a cheerful and confident player throughout a dominating career, hovered over his pieces in the deciding game of a match with an implacable challenger. Deep Blue, a computer. Kasparov won the first game in a breeze, but the next day he got the shock of his life. To Kasparov, Deep Blue played the second game much more strongly, differently. Unlike a computer, he said. Kasparov conceded, and the loss wore on his mind for the rest of the match. In each of the next 3 games, the world's preeminent chess players, man and machine, battled each other to a draw. Kasparov's early scorn for Deep Blue's abilities had proven a great mistake. In the final game, the computer led with the white pieces. And soon, Kasparov's fans had to admit that the once unthinkable might actually be happening. In 1996, after 7 years of research and development, a team at IBM believed they were ready to challenge Garry Kasparov. In Game 1 of 6, Deep Blue eked out its first win against the champion. Kasparov learned fast and won the match decisively. His confident proposal for a rematch in 1997 was immediately accepted by the IBM team. They were learning too. The afternoon of May 11th, 1997. Game 6, the deciding game. Deep Blue challenges Kasparov's brain with an array of 256 processors that can examine 200 million possible moves every second. They call it the brute force approach. Grandmasters had coached IBM's programmers to deepen Deep Blue's book, its library of what humans knew from experience about how to win. Deep Blue could now play as well as a grandmaster, with all the benefits of hindsight. In the early moves of Game 6, playing by its book of openings, then in the mid-game, analyzing millions of possible scenarios by sheer brute force, Deep Blue has led Kasparov into making a poor move. Kasparov is rattled. He defends what he can, but it's clear that the computer will reliably do what he himself would do. And he recognizes that he has already lost. On Deep Blue's 19th move, the champion resigns. For people watching around the world, it is a slow motion moment.
Deep Blue has defeated world champion Garry Kasparov in an absolutely stunning.
IBM retired Deep Blue and it never competed again. But the improvement of chess software did not stop in 1997. Today, inexpensive computers, with their large memories and sophisticated software, can play chess as well as Deep Blue did with its massively parallel processors. Yet Deep Blue versus Kasparov was justly called historic. The programmers had proved it was possible to build a chess-playing machine that could defeat the best human opponent. Nevertheless, The machine they had built did not play chess by thinking in the same way a human does. A machine that can think remains the dream, and it's still many years and quite a few startling breakthroughs away.
In January 2003, Kasparov played with Deep Junior. Deep Junior evaluated 3 million positions per second. The game ended with a draw. In November of 2003, Kasparov played against the X3D Fritz using a virtual board, 3D glasses, and a speech recognition system. After two draws and one win apiece, the X3D Fritz man-machine match ended in a draw. The Minimax algorithm selects the best next move for a computer player in a two-player game. The algorithm makes a tree of all possible moves for both players. This algorithm is called Minimax simply because the computer makes moves that bring it maximum gain, while assuming the opponent makes moves that brings the computer minimum gain. Because the players alternate moves, the algorithm alternates between minimizing and maximizing levels of the recursive search tree. Now let's see the steps for Minimax. First of all, apply the evaluation function in all leaf nodes of the tree. Until the root of tree gets a value, repeat. Starting from the leaves of the tree and moving to the root, transfer the values to intermediate nodes of the tree as follows. The value of each node max is the maximum of the values of its node's children. The value of each node mean is the minimum of the values of its node's children. Best move is the move that leads to the node that gave the most advantages to the root value. Now, we will watch an animation for the Minimax algorithm. Now let's see another algorithm. Alpha Beta is a search algorithm which seeks to decrease the number of nodes that are evaluated by the Minimax algorithm in its search tree. It is an adversarial search algorithm used commonly for machine playing of two-player games such as tic-tac-toe and chess. It stops completely evaluating a move when at least one possibility has been found that proves the move to be worse than a previously examined move. Such moves need to be evaluated further. When applied to a standard Minimax tree, it returns the same move as Minimax would, but prunes away branches that cannot possibly influence the final decision. Alpha Beta pruning does not play any better moves. It just plays the same moves more quickly. Apparently, if used properly, it considers the square root of the number of positions that Minimax alone will consider, so, since Minimax is exponential in the depth, you can go twice as far down the game tree in the same time, and thereby playing better moves. To formalize the idea of alpha beta, we will keep track of two numbers, alpha and beta, for each node we're analyzing, hence the name for this algorithm, alpha beta pruning. Alpha will be the value of the best possible move you can make that you have computed so far. Beta will be the value of the best possible move your opponent can make that you have computed so far. If at any time alpha is greater or equal than beta, then your opponent's best move can force a worse position than your best move so far, and so there is no need to further evaluate this move. The same pruning condition applies if you are the mean player, except instead of finding the move that yields alpha, you find the move that yields beta. Here is an example of the alpha-beta pruning. Here are some chess to make your game playing more interesting and more fun.
Thanks for watching us!